In this video, I'm going to discuss some methods for placing different kinds of patterns onto surface of a mass. So I'm going to give two examples of defining floor levels on a given mass, and then on one surface, defining the grid, diagonals, random lines, and a diagrid. So I'm going to start with a basic rectangle and then twist and scale that rectangle and loft and move it vertically and then loft it. So I've done that through three operations. Rotate, so rotating that original rectangle, moving it vertically in the Z direction by some height that I want, and scaling. So in this case, I'm scaling the copied one. Well, you can put these in any order that you could like. You could scale it first, and then move it, and then rotate it, or move it, and then rotate and scale it. Doesn't really matter. As long as in the end you loft between the third one and the original. So this is going back to the basic rectangle I have over here. And then I'm capping that to get us a nice solid mass, which is we're able to adjust in height, in the amount of twist that it has, and the amount that it kind of tapers as it goes up. So on this basic mass, I want to put some additional lines that start to represent the paneling on the exterior walls. So there's two methods that I want to go over to define the floor levels. One is to just define the number of floors, and it will divide those equally, make equal divisions on the surface. And the other is to define the number of floors and the floor-to-floor height. So first, what we'd want to do is bring in this bottom rectangle and then just array that in the Z direction to by the height of the building. So we are bringing in here the height that we defined and dividing that by the number of floors that we want. Have this operation to subtract one or to add one so that we can define the number of floors, 1, 2, 3. If we didn't do that, it would not give us the top. It would only give us it would count this the bottom one as one of the three. So we need to add one. So then what we want, you can notice that these are extending outside of the original mass. We can then use this intersection to define each of the slabs, the intersection of each of these levels and the original mass. And then we can use the boundary to create a floor level for each of those. So let's turn off this original. We can see each of these levels, which are add more or less levels, and they're all doing the same twisting and tapering. So the other method is to define by floor height. So what we do here is it's just a similar array. But instead of basing this on the overall height of the building, this is based on the floor-to-floor height. So I have 10 floors always here, and I'm changing, raising or lowering the height between each of those floors. Or I can define the height the floor-to-floor height and change the number of floors. So this will take off slabs and leave the floor-to-floor height the same. And then down here, I'm simply just extruding that basic shape and capping to get a similar mass of a rectangular extruded building. Alright, so let's keep this capped, this basic rectangle on here, and talk about another method, which is to put a grid on the surface. So we're going to deconstruct that, explode that this rectangular prism mass, so that we can get this one surface which we're going to work with for the next several examples. And there is a basic placing a grid onto this form, which is this subsurface, so isotrim subsurface. And what we need, so you plug it the surface that you want to divide in there, and then you need to have this divide domain. So to plug into that is this divide domain squared. And let's turn this on so I can see what that's actually doing. So the U and the V are the number of panels that will give. So the U direction in this case is going vertically. So this has five panels vertically. And this the V is across, so we have six. We can adjust that to whatever numbers we want. And by the way, we can also just, instead of defining this as a separate number slider, we could plug that back into the number of floors of floor-to-floor height that we defined earlier, and have it all be linked in that way. So let's decrease this a little bit again. And so that's pretty helpful to have some panels, pretty standard panels placed on a grid. We can now select each of these individual panels and apply even more patterns. So in this script here, we're going to apply some circles to each of those. And show what that looks like. We get this evaluate surface. So, and it's saying that it basically finds the center of each of those surfaces, the center point. And it has 48 because this we have 6 times 8, 48 panels. So it has each of those 48. What we want to do is use that center point for a center point of a circle. So I'm placing circles on each of those. As you can see, they're not, well, two things. I've placed a random node in here so that I get a whole, they're not all the same radius, these circles. They're all random diameters based on, or radius based on this number that I'm, the range that I'm placing here. And they're also horizontal, so we want to rotate each of those so that they're actually in the plane of the surface. So we get the center point of each of those circles, and we need to rotate it. But this rotate, if you hover over here and look and let's see, read, but it actually, the angle, it is in radians. And we typically thinking not in radians, but in degrees. So I want to rotate this 90 degrees. And I need to Google what the difference between degrees and radians is. And it's, if I divide this 90 by 57, 0.2958, I will get radians. So if I now turn on these, they will be, turn off the original circles, They will be in the vertical plane. And so we can see possibly more clearer that they're each on the surface when they're smaller. But it could be a really interesting patterning making to have them be larger. And then what I've done next is to trim these circles so that they are all to stay on the facade. We can actually even, let's see, turn off the subsurface. So now we have these kind of seemingly random circles that I create a pattern on our surface. So the next one here, diagonals, I'm actually linking this back to the subsurface. And I'm deconstructing that subsurface. So now I get each of the vertices, the four vertices of those panels. And those are related to each of these four items. So I'm getting the corners. So this, let's see, this one is. This is the kind of bottom left of each panel. This is the bottom right. The top left. And the top right. And I can then just use basic simple lines to connect those. And if I can turn off the subdivide grid, I'll have some diagonals that I've defined kind of manually, which are connected back to the way that I define the U and V values of the subdivide. Then now, so next, I want to. If I didn't want diagonal lines, I wanted something, some more random lines. This is another again deconstructing those that surface. But instead of looking at the vertices this time, I want to get each of the edges. So this one. Turn on. Well, it's not letting me highlight because there's something on top. But I think if I go to the next step, it will. If I so I'm going to subdivide each of those edges. So this item or index zero for that surface is the top, the bottom, the left side, and the right side. So I have. And again, I've used this divide a lot. I can linking all of them in, so I have the same number of points on each side. And then I basically I want to collect them in two categories: one for each, or two into two merge nodes. All four of these are going into. This is the exact same thing, but these will represent the ends of the points. So the A endpoint and B endpoint of a line. So all those points come into here, and then again I use this random node to decide to randomly pick one of the points along the edge to connect to another randomly defined point on the other end. And what we get is some lines that are kind of random lines connecting points across. So this is all adjustable. We can increase or decrease the number of points, and we can increase or decrease the number of lines that are that a number of points that are defined. Kind of takes some playing with this to get it exactly where it makes sense to you. those would be if you kind of operations like this, you had some random lines. And then this last one is part. I show as an example because I showed up here the diagonals, kind of manually making those diagonals. If you get the Bunchbox plugin under structure here, there's some predefined patterns under structure and also under panels, and those might be helpful. I wanted you to know how to do that manually. If it's not helpful, sometimes this doesn't exactly give you the way you want to panelize or pattern your facade. So, but sometimes it does. So I wanted to show you how that one works. So it's kind of similar to the subdivide, but bringing in this isolated surface and then defining a U and V for the diagrid. I say that it doesn't exactly do it what you need it to do because if you look, giving it this low, kind of lower, the way that this counts the divisions is not quite intuitive. It says it's four, so the four is vertically in this case. So it's counting that from the bottom one, two to the midway point, three, four, and eight will be from the top one, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. So if you can kind of calibrate this the way to make it work for you, that is great. If not, you know how to kind of do it with some more nodes up there. And so what I did here was I just want the lines, not the nodes, and just create a line node to link to here and then turn off the preview of that one. So those are some methods to get started on patterning for facades.